soul journeying, shamanic tools for finding your destiny and recovering your spirit, written by Alberto Villoldo and read by Robert G. Slade. To my mother, Elena Villoldo, who showed me the way of love, and to La Loba. Preface. This book is the result of more than 25 years of research and training with the shamans of the Americas. The rites of passage I underwent in the high mountains of the Andes and the low jungles of the Amazon adhered to ancient tradition and required months of preparation. My quest to discover the healing traditions of this continent was guided by an old Inca, Don Antonio. My adventures with this renowned healer are chronicled in my earlier books, Shaman, Healer, Sage, Dance of the Four Winds, and Island of the Sun. The soul retrieval techniques in this book represent my contemporary reinterpretation of ancient healing practices that are still in use in North and South America. Among Hispanic and Native American communities throughout the U.S., when children suffer from susto, or fright, they're taken to a special place to retrieve the part of their soul that was lost or taken from them. I've adapted and translated these practices within a modern scientific context. Destiny retrieval practices have been lost among most Aboriginal societies. Yet I was very fortunate to spend many years with the Leka masters, seers of the Inca nation, where I learned these skills. Please keep in mind that the practices I'm going to share with you in this book are extraordinarily powerful and effective, and must only be used with the strongest code of ethics and integrity. In fact, much of the shaman's lengthy training is spent developing a high sense of ethics founded on a deep reverence for all life. Only then can the techniques and processes be properly mastered and used to heal others. Similarly, a Western medical doctor spends at least 5 years learning his or her craft. Is it prudent to turn my physical or mental health care over to someone who's taken a weekend workshop in shamanism or energy medicine? This is the quandary for Westerners who take a short course in the healing arts. If you have a calling to practice these healing arts, be sure to take the time to train with teachers whose integrity, wisdom, and technical knowledge will assist you in developing your individual spiritual gifts. My own journey into shamanism was guided by my desire to become whole. In healing my own soul wounds, I learned to love myself and others. I walked the path of the wounded healer and learned to transform the grief, pain, anger, and shame that lived within me into sources of strength and compassion. At the Healing the Light Body School that I direct, every student embarks on a quest for self-healing in which he or she transforms soul wounds into sources of power and wisdom. Students learn that this is one of the greatest gifts that they'll later offer their clients, the opportunity to discover the power and wisdom within their own healing journey. Of course, I'm not the first to bring to light the ancient healing practices of the Americas. The anthropologist Margaret Mead opened the door for all of us who follow in her footsteps, and my friend and colleague Sandra Ingerman, with her groundbreaking book Soul Retrieval, Mending the Fragmented Self, was the first to make us aware of the power and beauty of these ancient healing practices, as well as provide us with a practical guide for healing ourselves. A number of others, including Hank Wesselman and John Perkins, have also built bridges that have allowed many to cross into the realm of indigenous spirit. Finally, I want to state that the healing methods in this book are my own synthesis and interpretation of ancient healing practices. I do not speak for my teachers, for the Inca, or for Native American shamans. Although I've had the privilege of training with the finest Inca medicine people, I make no claim to be representing a body of Inca traditions. The practices of soul retrieval and destiny retrieval described herein are adaptations of what I learned during my training as a shaman, and I take full responsibility for them. Alberto Villoldo, Ph.D. www.thefourwinds.com. Introduction. During the 1980s, I spent countless hours in a laboratory studying the human mind, searching for some tangible evidence of the consciousness lurking within the gray matter inside our heads. I was fascinated by the mind's extraordinary power to create psychosomatic disease, and it was this fascination that led me into the field of psychology, and later to medical anthropology. After a while, I began to think that rather than hunting for scientific answers in millions of brain synapses, I might have to explore a different approach to investigating human consciousness. I began with the theory that in the same way that we can create psychosomatic disease, the mind must also be able to create psychosomatic health. I set out to look for experts who could provide me with insights into how we humans could train the mind to heal itself and to transform the body. From my anthropological studies, I knew of indigenous cultures in South America where shamans were reported to perform miraculous healings, both in person and from a distance. I decided to travel into their worlds with a scientific mind, yet leaving myself open to what I might discover. I purchased a good hunting knife and a sturdy pair of hiking boots, and I set out from the confines of my laboratory at San Francisco State University on a quest that would take me to the jungles of the Amazon, and finally to Inca shamans living in remote villages thousands of feet up in the Andes Mountains of Peru. I was one of the first anthropologists to have extensive communication with these wisdom keepers, known as the Leica. Since they're among the last remaining Inca, they've had very little contact with outsiders, and their teachings have been undiluted by missionaries or other Western influences. More important to my studies, the Leica still practice healing techniques that their ancestors cultivated for thousands of years, and handed down from teacher to student in their medicine societies. At first, the shamans in each village I visited were very reluctant to share their heritage with me, a Westerner and a complete stranger. But I eventually gained their trust. On my early journeys, I observed that many children in the villages were suffering from the illnesses of civilization, including intestinal disorders that ran rampant among babies. Since the ailments didn't respond to local herbs and cures, I began to bring medications with me to treat the children. Over time, the villagers began to see me as a healer of sorts. So they introduced me to their healers, and through them, I met many others. Don Antonio Morales, who was on the faculty of the University of Cusco and was a full-blooded Inca, became my primary mentor. I walked with him through the high mountains of the Andes, meditating in sacred sites and ancient temples. I also studied with medicine women of the highlands, who taught me about power animals and showed me how to merge my consciousness with that of a jungle cat and a condor. Despite my training in Western science, I learned to open my inner vision. I discovered the maps to the lower world of our past, and to the upper world of our becoming, and the techniques of soul retrieval and destiny retrieval, the very same processes that you'll learn in this book. The Different Worlds. The Leica divide the collective unconscious of all humanity into three parts: the lower, middle, and upper worlds. These aren't physical places, but rather archetypal and energetic domains. As June Singer, the renowned Jungian analyst, wrote, "The wonder of the collective unconscious is that it is all there, all the legend and history of the human race with its unexorcised demons and its gentle saints, its mysteries and its wisdom, all with each one of us, a microcosm within the macrocosm. The exploration of this world is more challenging than the exploration of outer space. The world we live in, where we work and raise our families, is the middle world. The upper world is the invisible domain of our destiny and our spirit. And the lower world, where the record of all human history is held, is the realm of the soul. Now, in the middle world, we perceive time to be linear. Tomorrow always follows today, so it's difficult to imagine how we could travel into the past or future. But by using the technique of journeying that I'll detail, we can visit the upper and lower worlds, and it's here that time loops and wormholes into the past and the future. In this book, I'll teach you how to travel to the upper world to find your highest destiny, in order to manifest the meaning and purpose in your life. But you'll also journey to the lower world, where your childhood and your former lifetimes reside, to recover the lost parts of your soul. These soul parts will take the form of beings, a frightened 7-year-old, an anguished mother, or even a cruel taskmaster. You'll learn their stories, heal their wounds, and write new contracts that will free them from their burdens. Then you'll retrieve these healed soul parts and bring them back to the present. You'll discover your hidden gifts, which you may use in your everyday life in the middle world, and you'll retrieve a power animal who will put you back in touch with your natural instincts. The Four Chambers of the Lower World. The lower world is the primordial Eden, which legend says we've all lost. It's an earthly paradise that you can return to any time, where your lost soul parts have remained in grace and innocence. This realm is divided into four chambers, each containing a record of your soul's history. Number one. The first of these is the Chamber of Wounds, where you discover the original wounding that caused part of your soul to flee and to derail the course of your destiny. Here you won't be looking for the most recent manifestation of this injury, which may be a lost relationship or a personal crisis, but for its source. It may be something that happened to you as a small child, or an incident that occurred while you were still in the womb. It's often a traumatic experience from a former lifetime. Everyone has an original wound that replays itself in many guises. It becomes a recurring theme in life, oftentimes repeating a script of scarcity, loss, lack of love, betrayal, or abandonment within a family and across generations. 2. The second chamber is the Chamber of Contracts, where you'll discover the soul promises that you've made. Many of these will be terrible obligations that you agreed to before you were even born, and of which you have no conscious knowledge. Most were entered into during the fear and stress of your original wounding, and often you're unaware that they exist. In this chamber, you can renegotiate the terms of an agreement that was badly worded, and that has sentenced you to a life of repeated suffering. Number 3. The third is the Chamber of Grace. Here you'll find your healed soul part, which is ready to return to you with all its life force. Grace is the fuel that propels you forward in life, what brings joy and peace. It isn't enough to journey to discover the pathology created by your wounds. You must also seek beauty, harmony, and the unique gifts of your soul. Sometimes when I'm working with a client, I find that her life force has become like a small fire that's nearly disappeared from what was once a roaring, raging blaze. The flickering flame that's left is barely enough to warm the soul. I see this often in my clients who are suffering from chronic fatigue, anxiety, and depression. By retrieving her missing soul part, my client can then return to her natural state of grace and aliveness.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.